This video was brought to you by Epidemic Sound, the best place for royalty-free music and sound effects for filmmakers and video creators. Follow the link in the description below to start a free 30-day trial and tell them that Ryan sent you. Now, on with the video. Hey guys, Ryan here with a quick beginner's tutorial on how to use keyframes in Adobe Premiere Pro CC to create simple VFX and motion within your films and video projects. And stick around until the end of the video because I'm going to be showing you a slightly more advanced tool that will help you create a good foundation for VFX work in your future projects. Before we get started, thank you so much for clicking on this video. This channel is all about learning and growing as a filmmaker. So please like, share, and subscribe if you haven't already, and let's become better filmmakers together. Okay, so first off, what are keyframes in Adobe Premiere Pro? Keyframes are basically points that you can set on the effects timeline that will allow you to change the properties, speed, motion, and things like that of an effect over time. In this tutorial, I will go over how to add an effect and how to use keyframes to change them in various ways. Now, I use keyframes in almost every film or video I create to do things like create motion in my shots, add simple VFX to my images, and even create simple animations. This is a very important tool to learn how to use if you edit with Adobe Premiere Pro. Let's take a few frames from my most recent film, 2AM, and I'll show you a few ways you can use keyframes to affect your footage. Let's start off with the scale and opacity keyframe effects, which are probably two of the simplest of all of them to learn. Position, scale, and opacity are just some of the effects or attributes that are automatically applied and available in the effects window to every clip that you've placed on your timeline. As you can see, when we play this clip, this is a static tripod shot that features no motion whatsoever. Let's start with the scale effect, which can increase or decrease the size of a clip, to slowly zoom in on this shot and give it a bit of life and motion. As you can see, we've brought our clip over here into the timeline, and as soon as we placed it and have selected it, this list of effects will populate up here in the effects window. Now keep in mind that workspaces in Adobe Premiere Pro can be customized, and I'm using the default editing workspace, just for your reference. Be sure that when you want to edit the effects of a particular clip, make sure that you have the correct clip selected and highlighted in your main timeline. That way you are presented with the appropriate list of effects for that clip. I can't tell you how many times I've been editing effects up here in the effects window and realized that I was affecting the wrong clip. So just make sure that you have the correct clip selected. This shot just happens to be the same exact size as our frame that we are working in, so that is a good place to start. We can go over here into the effects window and you can see we have our various basic clip effects that are automatically populated: position, scale, rotation, opacity, just to name a few. You'll also see that each effect has a stopwatch emblem. This is how we enable the keyframe timeline effects. Note that if we change the effect's value before hitting the stopwatch icon, this will just change the clip indefinitely and will not create an effect that changes over the course of time. So in simpler terms, if you just want to change, say, the scale of your clip without having it change over time, just change the value without hitting the stopwatch, and it will remain the scale that you set for the duration of that clip. Hopefully that makes sense. But we want to add motion, so we're going to hit the stopwatch icon. Notice that when you hit the stopwatch icon, it will automatically place a keyframe, which is this little diamond shape here, on the effects timeline at whatever point your timeline marker is currently sitting at. We want to start our motion at the very start of the clip. So if your first keyframe was created in a spot you didn't intend, don't worry. You can grab and move these keyframes around however you like. Notice that when a keyframe is selected, it will turn blue on the timeline. So we will select this keyframe and move it to the start of the clip. Notice that the scale value, which is this blue number right here, is set to 100, which is what I wanted. If you decide that you wanted a different starting value, you can select the individual keyframes and delete them to start over. As long as the stopwatch is enabled, Anytime you set or change a value, it will automatically place a keyframe at the point you're currently sitting at on the timeline. But if you want to delete all of your keyframes at once and start over, just disable the stopwatch and it will delete all the keyframes for that effect on that selected clip. Then you can just set your value to the desired starting point. Make sure you're setting at the time you want the effect to start and re-enable the stopwatch to get started again. Now we have our starting point. But for an animation to work, it needs to know where you want the motion to end up. So we will scrub over to somewhere closer to the end of our clip and drag our scale value to the right. Right will increase the size and left will decrease the size. We want to zoom in, so we're going to increase the size of our clip over time. Note that you can also type in values if you want, but I find that when I'm doing something visual like this, I like to have a visual representation of how I'm affecting the clip in real time. So I prefer to drag the values when I can. Once you drag and release the value to a point that you like, it will automatically create a keyframe on the timeline for you. We want this change to start and end at the beginning and end of our clip, so I will drag the end keyframe to the very end of the clip if it's not already. Note that the closer two keyframes are to one another, the faster the animation will happen. So as you can see, when I move this end clip closer to my starting keyframe, the zoom becomes much faster. But wherever that end keyframe rests, that is where your animation will end. We want a slow, gradual zoom in for this clip, so I will move it back out to the end where we had it before, and as you can see, it slows the zoom in quite a bit. You can do this exact same thing with an effect like opacity. Opacity controls how see-through or opaque the clip is on the timeline. Depending on what is sitting underneath that clip on the timeline, we can use opacity to dissolve clips into one another or create fade-ins like I'm about to show you how to do now. By default, your frame background is usually going to be black, so we don't have to add anything under our clip to get this fade-in effect working properly. Let's go ahead and move our effects timeline scrubber to the very start of the clip and enter a value of 0 for our opacity. This will make the clip completely invisible, which will show through the black background underneath. Now, let's hit the stopwatch to enable the keyframes. Now we can move out a little bit to a further point in the timeline to give this effect some time to work, and increase our opacity value back up to 100%. Now when we play, we've created a simple fade-in effect that we can play around with and get just how we want. Move the keyframes closer or further apart to speed it up or slow it down. And if we want to get more advanced, we can add multiple changes in the values to create multiple keyframes, add easing for smoother motion, and get really creative. But that stuff is best suited for another video. Let's end this tutorial by taking a look at the position effect, which can be a really powerful VFX tool if you learn how to use it properly. If you've been learning about video editing, you've probably heard the terms motion tracking or rotoscoping. Well, the position effect is the most basic building block and foundation for a lot of that stuff. We're basically going to be manually creating an effect that resembles the most basic forms of stuff that people are using motion tracking for. And hopefully it will help you get a better basic understanding of motion VFX before you dive into all of that more advanced stuff later on as you learn. I use the position effect to add movement and animation to things like lower thirds, PNG graphics, or even create more advanced VFX stuff like the face of my monster in 2AM. It can get a little bit more confusing than the two previous keyframe effects as you're working with multiple variables like horizontal and vertical attributes. So let's focus and see if we can explain this for you guys in a way that's beneficial. Let's start with something simple, like moving a PNG graphic or a title around on screen. First, we're going to import our PNG graphic and place it on the timeline above our video clip. PNG graphics are important to use because the backgrounds of PNG graphics can be opaque, and we don't see any outlines or color variations around the part of the image that we actually want to show up. I've placed my graphic on the timeline, and we can go ahead and use scale to get it the size we want and even move it around to get it in a good starting position. I actually want to have this graphic whip in from the left side of the frame and rest in the center of the image. So we will move our graphic outside of the frame and out of sight for its starting position. You'll notice that as you move your graphic around in the frame, the variable numbers for position will change in the effects window. But no keyframe will be created because we don't have the stopwatch enabled yet. Once we have our graphic moved out of frame where we want the animation to start, we can now click the stopwatch icon at the point in time where we want this animation to begin on the effects timeline. Note that with these PNG graphics, if you want the animation to happen over the course of a longer amount of time, just increase the clip's length on the main timeline to give yourself more time to play with. Now, this is where the position effect can get a little trickier than the effects we covered earlier. We will already have our starting keyframe position, which is out of frame. We want to move our graphic into frame, rest in the center of the frame for a few seconds so people can read it, and then move back out of the frame. This will take multiple keyframes, as we will need to start and stop the animation at various different times. Let's first move our timeline scrubber out a few seconds into the clip for a time and place to have this second keyframe appear. The two number variable beside of position in the effect window affects the horizontal and vertical positioning of the clip. The one on the left will change the horizontal position, and the value to the right will affect the vertical position. Let's drag the horizontal effect up to move our graphic back into frame and create a keyframe. Once it's resting in the desired spot, you can stop dragging. When we preview our project, you can see that it's moving really slow. How do we change that? That's right, move the keyframes closer to one another. But now we want to wait a few seconds and have the graphic move back out of frame to the left again. Let's move our timeline scrubber a few seconds into the future again and drag the horizontal value back down to see what happens. Okay, it's kind of doing what we want, but it's not resting in the center of the frame so people can actually have time to read it. So, we have to create stop keyframes and let the animation rest before it concludes. So here's how I do it. Let's delete our final keyframe that tells our graphic to move back out of frame, just for the sake of not being confusing. This little icon here is the Add Keyframe tool. This basically tells the program to add another keyframe wherever you are on the timeline, using whatever values the effect is currently sitting at. We want to duplicate our second keyframe a few seconds after it appears on the timeline to give it a few seconds to breathe and allowing our animation to rest in the center of the screen before we move it back out of frame again. The amount of time after its first initial stop is up to you. It's just however long you want the graphic to remain still and in the center of the screen so people can read it. I'll give it a few seconds and then I will drag my horizontal value back down to tell the graphic where I want it to end up off of screen. It doesn't have to go very far off screen, just enough to get out of sight. Now let's play it and see what happens. Boom, exactly the motion we were looking for. Now we can play around with the keyframes in the timeline until we get everything moving and resting at the speeds we want. Remember, the closer two keyframes are to one another, the faster the movement. And that's it, guys. That's about the most basic way I can demonstrate keyframes in Adobe Premiere. Learning this is just the beginning. There is so much you can do with these tools. The sky is the limit. Every effect available in Premiere can be changed and adjusted in various ways like this on the effects timeline. If you'd like to see how I used keyframe animation to create my monster's face in my new short film 2AM, just follow the link to my behind-the-scenes video featured at the end of this video. I hope you found this video very beneficial, and if you did, please be sure to let me know in the comments below. Give this video a thumbs up and subscribe if you haven't already. Thank you so much for coming along on this filmmaking journey with me. I am Ryan, and I will see you on the next video. Bye-bye.